Hey there, everyone. Welcome back to Utility Sports. And as you can see from the title, the thumbnail, and what you got on the screen right now, it's 2023 NBA draft season. I'm so excited to be back bringing more NBA mock drafts and bringing more NBA player profiles for these prospects. And there's going to be a lot to watch and talk about. Of course, this is the preseason edition. So just so you guys know, this order is not going to be perfectly correct by the end of the year. The players that probably go in some spots probably not going to be perfectly correct because we haven't even seen most of these freshmen play a minute of college basketball yet. But at some point, everything will get ironed out and we're going to get this as accurate as possible. I have put a lot of time and effort into making sure I was ready for this video, which is why I've taken a brief break from posting about the 2023 NBA draft. But as you guys can tell, we're going to come back, hit this pretty hard, expect probably a mock draft once every couple weeks or so. And we're going to really, throughout the entire process of the regular season here, talk about the NBA draft a ton. So if this is the place that you want to be for that type of content, I would love to have you hit that subscribe button right now. It would go a long way. I'd really appreciate it. And also make sure to hit that like button. It lets me know that you did enjoy today's video. So without further ado, let's jump into it. The date I'm recording this is October 4th, 2022. The reason I put that in here, someone in December or January is going to say, whoa, you have that guy going that low? Look, I'm recording this before college basketball starts. There's going to be stuff that shifts around and everything. This is kind of where I'm at with these prospects at this point. And there's a lot of guys I would have loved to include in this video as well. 30 spots for this first round mock and probably about 40 players I wanted to include, which naturally means there's some guys that got left off. Hint, hint, Leonard Miller playing for the G League Ignite. He's one of those guys. And if you disagree with my draft order, for example, the team I have picking one or seven, just roll with the punches, please. I can't perfectly predict the entire regular season with how it's going to go. I know that's the expectation for some reason. Unfortunately, I'm going to, probably sell you guys just a little bit short there. I'm not perfect. I don't know everything that's about to happen. I try my best. I educate myself to do the best I can, but I'm wrong every once in a while. Not too often, but every once in a while. Let's go ahead and jump into it now. The team I have picking number one, the San Antonio Spurs. And the day I have this video coming out will be October 5th. And I'm recording this very late at night on October 4th because what just happened in the NBA world was a great matchup between Victor Wembanyama and Scoot Henderson. I have a video that breaks down that game a lot. The nice thing is on October 6th, they play again. The Metropolitans 92 are going to stay in Henderson, Nevada, and will take on Scoot Henderson and the G League Ignite one more time this year. And this video is going to be sandwiched right in between those games. What I saw from that game tonight was there's two players in this draft that are must-have, can't-miss prospects. Victor Wembanyama and Scoot Henderson. Both of those guys are phenomenal prospects who in any given year could be the first overall pick. And pick one, San Antonio, you would think, hey, maybe that's a tough question. Then you've got two can't-miss guys. Who are they going to go with? They're going to go with the obvious one, the best prospect I have ever watched play basketball. And I evaluated Luka Doncic. I really liked Luka Doncic. I thought the Suns were going to take him first overall when they went with Ayton because they had hired his former EuroLeague coach. I just thought it made too much sense and they didn't do it. Here are the Spurs. They're not going to screw up. They're San Antonio. And I have them picking number one just based on how they played in the first preseason game. They really struggled. Obviously not a perfect indicator, but you look at the roster, no DeJounte Murray. They're probably going to be around this range. And again, there's going to be a lottery. This whole thing's going to get messed up. The point of a mock draft is to really get a feel of what's potentially going to happen. And it's not a, oh, this is 100% going to happen. If the Spurs do have the first pick, though, they will take Victor Wembanyama. You look back at their other former top picks, David Robinson, Tim Duncan. Victor Wembanyama fits the archetype here, right? A dominant center who everyone looks at as the number one player. And boy, did he prove it in Henderson, Nevada as well. 37 points, 7 3-pointers made for a guy who stands 7'3" plus. He had 5 blocks in that game, including 2 really impressive blocks on Scoot Henderson. He also blocked a shot from Leonard Miller all the way about 25 feet before it landed. He's huge and he is so gifted as well. There's not players like him who can advance the ball past the timeline, shoot from behind the 3-point line, handle the rock out on the perimeter, catch and move and shoot. It's just unheard of. He had a really nice spin layup early in that game as well. He protects the rim. The only thing he doesn't really do at an elite level right now that you would expect from a guy who's 7'3" is rebound. He's a little gangly. He's a little bit too easy to move on the block right now when it comes to boxing him out. He's got to get better in those areas for sure. If he puts on some weight and muscle, he will. But as of right now, Victor Wembanyama is the best prospect I've ever seen play basketball. He's the number one pick in this draft. If you see a mock draft that doesn't have him go number one overall, it's just incorrect. I'm really sorry. Scoot Henderson's an awesome player. He really is. I believe he's clearly the number two player in this class, and that's because Victor Wembanyama is just so talented, such a freak of nature. He moves quickly. He's huge, lengthy, paws. He does everything you want from a prospect. He's a 2K creative player. If you don't see him going first overall in a mock, it's wrong. Victor Wembanyama, first overall pick, book it for 2020 for the 2023 NBA draft. Now pick two, I have the Utah Jazz here at this spot, and Utah, they're going to be bad this year, and they're going to earn this selection, and if this happens, if Utah gets a top two pick, they have to feel really good about where they're at, because they're getting a player who's better than Donovan Mitchell in Scoot Henderson. I don't want to make it sound like Scoot Henderson's not in the conversation with Victor Wembanyama. He definitely is. Wembanyama's just too special, though, to pass up with his size and talent. Scoot Henderson, though, looked so good on October 4th as well in that matchup against the Mets 92 squad. He looked a lot more patient. He looks like the game's really slowed down for him. He threw so many pocket passes that I don't think last year he was capable of throwing. And then you also see times where not even just pocket passes, but just quick read decisions. There was a time he back cut off of a pass and caught it right around the block. And he made the instant kick to the strong side corner with him. And last year, he would have tried to finish that play. I know he would have. And maybe he's capable of that, but he got a teammate a wide open shot. That's something I was really impressed with by Scoot Henderson. In this matchup, he had 28 points, 9 assists. And the 9 assists are really what stood out to me. But boy, were the 28 points beautiful as well. He had some plays in there that I just could not believe, including an insane perimeter play where he dribbles the ball between his legs, gets toward the rim, contorts himself around Wembanyama and scores. He had no fear of attacking the rim when Victor Wembanyama was in there. That 8-foot wingspan did not bother Scoot one bit, and that was really impressive to me. And his shot selection also looks very improved. He went 2-for-3 from three. Last year, a year ago, you know, he shot 17% from three. Now, I think he's a better shooter than 17% from three. I really do. But part of that had to do with shot selection. He was just trying to assert himself in situations where he wasn't going to be as successful. This year, if he continues to play like he did in the first game of the G League Ignite season in that exhibition against the Mets 92, he's going to have an awesome year. And again, he's well deserving of a number one overall pick in most years. I think if he was in last year's class, I probably would have preferred him number one overall over Banchero and Chet and even Jaden Ivey. And you guys know how I felt about Jaden Ivey. I just think Scoot Henderson's at another level in terms of his playmaking ability now at this point. His demeanor, he's got that star attitude to him, but he's also really slowed his body down. He's able to hit pull-up jump shots now at an insane rate. I think he's going to be such a good, efficient star in this league. Scoot Henderson's a build-around guy, can jump out of the gym, good athlete. I think defensively needs to clean up some fundamentals, but he's a playmaker on that end. He's going to get in the passing lanes. He's going to try and pick your pocket, and when he does, it's going to be showtime. We're going to have some showtime Scoot for sure in his rookie season. And if it's with the Jazz, you got to feel so good about their future. They have all those draft picks, and then they get a player like Scoot Henderson, who's better than Donovan Mitchell, who's better than Rudy Gobert likely. My goodness, watch out. Pick three, we got the Houston Rockets, and this is where the draft starts. And I saw a funny quote on Twitter saying, I know what the draft's going to look like. Picks 1 and 2, Wembanyama, Scoot Henderson, 3 through 14, are going to be wishing they tanked harder or had better lottery luck. And I think that's honestly the truth at this point. But this is a very, very strong class. I want to emphasize again, this class is really awesome. I think the one issue, though, is 1 and 2 are so good that anyone who's picking 3 is going to feel disappointed naturally. But there's still a lot of really good players out here. And the player I'm going with here at this spot is forward Derek Whitehead. I had a little bit of issues with mocking Whitehead here. I did consider a few other players. But for Houston, the big reason why, what it says on his shirt, buckets never stop, is exactly what the motto is going to be there in Houston if they take Derek Whitehead, who is one of the more talented shooters I've evaluated in recent years. Think Ben Mathurin plus. He's going to be able to knock down a ton of shots off of movement. In fact, Montverde ran a ton of down screens for him, flare screens as well. And he really operated well in the mid-range game as well. He was one of the more polished prospects I've evaluated up to this point in this draft cycle. And there's no surprise here that he's number three overall. He won National Player of the Year in high school a year ago, and that was well-deserved. He was, I think, the best high school player last season, and I don't even know if it was particularly close. Such a good young player, and someone that I would really want to rely on moving forward. If you think about it from Houston's perspective here, you have Jabari Smith at the four, Tari Eason, some type of forward, whether it's four, maybe you play some small ball five, whatever you want with him. I love Tari Eason's upside still. Alperen Sengun's in there. You have Jalen Green, Kevin Porter Jr., Ty Washington maybe plays a little bit of point guard for that team. And then you really fill that three spot with Derek Whitehead, who is a three-level shot maker. And I think the one thing, too, doesn't rely on his athleticism, but he has it. He can really jump as well. He's such a good all-around player. I think he's not as much of a playmaker as you would see like a Scoot Henderson, which is really what separates the two of them in massive ways. I think he's not nearly as good of a ball handler as Scoot Henderson either. But what I do know about Derek Whitehead is he's going to be able to get his shot off, and when he does, it's going to be bottoms rather consistently. I think the Rockets would be a really dangerous offensive team with Derek Whitehead, with a ton of athleticism, really good forwards. They have length, size. They would be a really fun team to watch, and this would really brighten their future as well. Pick number four, the Orlando Magic here, of course, headlined the draft last year. Pick number one took Paolo Banchero. I also like the Caleb Houston pick in round two. I think they did a pretty good job building up some of the young talent on this team. I think Jalen Suggs is going to have a better year two as well. Wendell Carter, still a really nice piece for them. Franz Wagner, I think, is going to have a very, very good year two. Orlando's dangerous, okay? Orlando's got some really good young pieces. I don't think they're going to put it all together here in year one. In fact, I would bet against them doing that, but I think that they're still going to be in this top five range where they can add some really good talent. And the player I really like for them, Amen Thompson. It keeps their options open here. Amen Thompson, I have him listed as a guard because I think he's capable of playing guard, but you could also utilize him as a forward if you later decide to do that and go with extra playmaking on the floor. If you do decide in the future, hey, maybe we want to add a guard to this combination. Amen Thompson at 6'7". He's the better Thompson twin. I think assuredly he's the better one. He's very athletic as well. He's going to be someone who, although I think a little bit raw, I don't love the top end of his jump shot right now. I think his release mechanics are a little busted. Not like they're crippling by any extent, but I think that they could be improved upon. I think that there's going to be some refinement needed there. He's just a very good raw player, though, at this point. Someone who this year for Overtime Elite, probably going to average close to 28-8 or 29-9. Now, take that with a grain of salt because Overtime Elite plays against a lot of prep schools. It's not quite the same thing as college or, you know, overseas like the NBL, EuroLeague. It's not quite the same thing as, you know, G League Ignite even. I think that Amen Thompson, his film's going to be a little bit harder to evaluate based on the level of competition he plays. But we did get to see him play against a Mega Basket team, and he looked really good in that one. I believe he finished with 9 rebounds, 9 assists, and 18 points, if I'm not mistaken. I did watch that game live. It was over a month ago, so excuse me. But Amen Thompson, very talented player. I love the upside here, and it gives Orlando a ton of different options down the road. If they whether they want to use him as a guard or a forward, they have their optionality still open at that point. And they could really build this team out with a ton of guys who can make plays, which I really like for their future. Pick five, Indiana Pacers here now at this spot. I do like the direction Indiana is heading in, though, but I think this year they're going to struggle to win a lot of games. You just look at their team. Halliburton, still relatively young. He's a good player. Benedict Mathurin's going to be one of their leading scorers, obviously a rookie. This team's not going to win a ton in year one here with this new core kind of building together, but that's okay because they find themselves in the top five. They just haven't been here in like 30 years. They have not had a top five pick in that long. Of course, pick six last year. And at five, I have them going with Derek Lively. And I know this is the part of the video where some people are going to be surprised, saying, whoa, you have Derek Lively this high? Yeah, I mean, you watch him. He's a freak physically. He has a lot of the same characteristics that James Wiseman had when Wiseman went second overall above LaMelo Ball. There's one thing that executives love, and it's the things you can't coach or teach. It's size, jumping ability, wingspan. Derek Lively's got all of that. He's also very good and adept at catching lobs. He's got really good feel as a role man. And I think realistically, he's going to be a force on the glass as well. And Indiana, you look at their long-term outlook right now, Miles Turner potentially on the trade block. He's been rumored in trades for the last 4 years, seemingly. So I don't think that they're basing their long-term decision-making on Derek Lively or on Miles Turner, excuse me. And I know, in fact, they aren't, because they wouldn't have tried to sign DeAndre Ayton had that been the case. So Derek Lively here, he could make some sense. Give Tyrese Haliburton and Ben Mathurin a really athletic rim-running center who's going to be really good in the pick-and-roll game. I like this fit a lot for Indiana. It maybe seems a little high as of right now to Lively, but this Duke team is going to be awesome. Dariq Whitehead, Derek Lively. They also have a couple other guys. You'll see one more of them in this video as well. This Indiana Pacers team gets a really nice player in Derek Lively, someone I think is going to really showcase himself well this year. Former five-star, you know, the tape speaks for itself. I love what I see in this kid, and I think he's going to be really productive at the NBA level, doing all the things that you want a good NBA center to do for you. Pick six, we have the Oklahoma City Thunder here now. And funny enough, in a year that you would want picks one and two, they only have one draft pick this entire draft. Despite owning so many draft picks over the next however many years, they find themselves with only one at this point in this draft, and it's theirs. Obviously, they have a swap with the Clippers, but the Clippers are going to be better than the Thunder, so they have this pick right now. And I have them taking Nick Smith Jr., and this is probably the floor of how low Nick Smith Jr. could go. I have him going six here to Oklahoma City, even though this is not a need for them by any stretch of the imagination. Obviously, clearly, it is not. But for Indiana, I think that Indiana would be in the mindset of, hey, let's build our team out. Let's get the right players in here that fit amongst each other. As for Oklahoma City, it's all about talent acquisition. Draft Nick Smith Jr., figure it out later. That's what Sam Presti's going to do. No surprise by that about that to anybody. He wants to get the best player on draft night, regardless of what that looks like. He's going to take the guy at the top of his board. Nick Smith Jr. here is just clearly the best player available. He's a very talented ball handler. He's, I think, going to have a really great season at Arkansas as well, playing with two other guys you're going to see in this video later on under a really great coach who's really built up that Arkansas Razorback program. And Nick Smith Jr., on top of just, you know, being a really good floor general playmaker, I think he's a very decisive athlete in terms of his ability to get to places quickly. Once he goes, and he's really tough to stay in front of. And one other thing I really like about him, he mitigates some of the shot blocking around him by being a really nice runner shooter. He shoots a ton of floaters, and he's very consistent and adept at that shot. I think Nick Smith Jr. is going to have a really nice freshman season at Arkansas, and I would be absolutely shocked if he's not a top six pick, honestly, at this point. He just seems like a lock to me to be in this category. He's just so talented. Again, I can't get over Nick Smith Jr.'s game. He's crafty defensively. He's going to get in the passing lanes. He's going to pick some pockets. Nick Smith Jr., a good player, and in most classes probably would be a top three pick even in this class, though. One of the best classes I think I've ever evaluated, just even up to this point, without having seen a lot of these freshmen even play collegiate games yet. I'm just so thoroughly impressed with the tape. The high school tape, any of the overseas tape, USA basketball tape, they're all really, really talented. They're very athletic. There's a lot of length and size in this class. And yet Nick Smith Jr., as a smaller player at the guard position, he still impresses me more than most of these guys. I see him going in the top six. Oklahoma City gets a really good player here. They'll figure out the fit later. I know, don't love that. Would love for them to just naturally slide somebody in, but with Lively off the board, with Wembanyama off the board, I think right now is not the spot to try and take a big, just because that's what you need. Pick seven, we have the Detroit Pistons here now. And for a team that addressed their big this past draft with Jalen Duren, and they addressed the guard spot with Jaden Ivey, you really turn your eyes to the wing. And while this is a great draft to do that, there's a lot of talented wings out there. And one that's really been the headliner for a lot of people, Dylan Mitchell. Very, very good athlete. Played at Montverde with Dariq Whitehead. And this guy played cleanup a ton. He is very assertive on the offensive glass. He would attack offensive rebounds, and he would put them home most of the time as well. He's a player who I think is capable of doing more than he did this past year at Texas, or at Montverde. And I think we'll see that at Texas this year. Obviously, I think that there's a good infrastructure here as well, though, for the Longhorns. They have some transfers coming in, some very prominent ones. We'll talk about that in later videos. And I think Dylan Mitchell is going to be in a spot where at times he'll get asked to do more than he had to in high school, and it'll be good for his development and showcasing what he can do. But there's also the security blanket here of, hey, we have other good players around you. We don't need you to become the man on night one. And I think that with the infrastructure there now in Texas, you know, coach has been there a few years, build up the program. This is really the year I think Texas makes a jump in terms of what that program looks like. And I think Dylan Mitchell is going to have a big factor on that. I think he's going to play a really big role in doing so. And by the end of the year, I wouldn't be surprised if people are looking at him as the best player on that team. Tyrese Hunter is going to have something to say about that, though. They have a lot of good talent for sure. And I think he's really going to shine because of it. Detroit gets an athletic wing who I think can really help them at the three or four spot, whatever you decide Dylan Mitchell can be. He runs the floor hard. He operates off the baseline well, plays without the ball in his hands. But again, I think he's capable of having it a little bit more as well. He seems like the perfect fit as a forward next to Sadiq Bey. Kind of gives you some of the things Bey does not give you in terms of the athletic profile. And I think those two are going to really be great complementary forwards next to a backcourt of Cade Cunningham, Jaden Ivey, and then an ultimate starting center in Jalen Duren, who I think is a perfect fit onto this team as well. I really like the direction Troy Weaver is bringing the Detroit Pistons. Let's get some Detroit basketball hype in the chat. Pick eight, the New York Knicks here now. At this spot, again, Knicks fans are going to say, whoa, you think we're that bad of a team? No, the East is really good. The West is really good. There's going to be a lot of really good teams that miss the playoffs this year. I think the Knicks are a pretty good team, honestly. I like what they have on their roster. Is it enough to make the playoffs? Probably not this year, but I like what they have. But at pick eight, here they are, Brandon Miller on the board for them. Similar story to Dylan Mitchell, except I think that at Alabama, there's going to be a little bit more pressure on him to be the guy early on, which is kind of what I was getting at here a little bit. Brandon Miller's like that typical Alabama player where, hey, he's a top recruit, really good. He's going to go to Alabama. And the team's just not going to win as much. We saw it with Colin Sexton, saw it with JD Davison. Probably going to happen with Brandon Miller here as well, unfortunately. But I don't think that's going to detract from what he is as a prospect and a player. I think his length, athleticism, I think his skill set's going to mesh really well into the NBA. And I actually do think the Knicks are getting a good fit here in Brandon Miller, someone who's going to help bridge to the future. Obviously, that Evan Fournier contract right now is not looking good, but the Knicks, they have to play him. They started him in their preseason game just a day ago, and I think the Knicks are in a very good spot overall with where their team is, especially their young talent. You guys know I loved Obi Toppin. He's not the only Dayton player we're going to talk about in this video today, but Brandon Miller, I think a good talent. Again, you're looking at a forward here who offers length, athleticism, and is at one of those premier positions where everyone in the league is looking to add more forwards that can really help you on both ends of the court. I think Brandon Miller is one of those guys. He's gotten a lot of hype recently, and I think a good amount of it is deserved. Pick nine, we have the Washington Wizards. Sorry, Wizards fans, I chose the pink background because of your nice new pink jerseys you've got. Probably get used to seeing that color for you this year, as the Wizards probably going to rock those sweet jerseys pretty often. But pick nine, I think the point guard position is the position of need. I thought it last year and they went with Johnny Davis. I understood the reasoning with where they were. I mocked it a ton of times, but I still, every video, I felt like I said, hey, we need to find a point guard for Washington. They're trying this whole Monte Morris thing. Monte Morris is a very good backup point guard. He's one of the worst starting point guards you can have in the league. Quite frankly, he's not a starting point guard level caliber player. Maybe I get proved wrong this year, but I just don't believe I will. We saw him last year in the Nuggets. Well, there's a reason he's not on that team anymore. The Wizards here, they get a legitimate guy in Keontae George, who has been showing out all summer long for Baylor. And he's someone who's really solidified his stock with me over the summer with some of the overseas play that we've seen him play. And I think he's just executed a ton. And Scott Drew is one of those coaches that really does know how to coach up his guards. The other nice thing I like about Keontae George here in Baylor, he's got other older guards around him who are going to help him come up to speed a little bit quicker. And he's kind of got that dog mentality to him as a guard as well. He knows he can take over a game. He's got the scoring prowess to do it, but I think he's also developing as a playmaker. Washington needs a player like this. They need a Keontae George. The fact that they could be getting him here ninth overall in this draft is a really good pick, in my opinion. And he's someone who's going to fill a lot of their flaws that they have on this roster. Specifically, when you look at the point guard spot, you're just not going to win in today's league with Monte Morris as your starting point guard. You're not going to win. You're not going to win if he's your starting point guard. Again, I need to emphasize that. This is an immediate upgrade if they get Keontae George on draft night. If they end up higher, Nick Smith Jr. would be even better for them. But Keontae George right in that conversation as well. I think those two guards, there's going to be a lot of controversy between the two on which one's better. For me, I prefer Nick Smith Jr. at this point, but once we get a little bit further in the season, maybe Keontae George could leapfrog him. Pick 10, Sacramento Kings here now. Kings fans are going to say, whoa, you think we're not going to make the playoffs? I mean, it's possible you guys do, right? I'm not saying that you're not, but at this point, I kind of am saying you're not. So we'll see. I'm not writing off the Kings quite yet, but if they're picking 10, I wouldn't be shocked. We'll just put it that way. But here I have you guys going with Jairus Walker, who's going to be an absolute beast this year for the Houston Cougars. And honestly, I feel like I maybe even have him too low. He's a talented four who is highly athletic. Again, I have to emphasize highly. And this feels like a little bit of a redundant pick because they did draft Keegan Murray last year. But one thing we've seen from Monty McNair, he's going to draft best player available. He did it with Davion Mitchell. He did it with Tyrese Halliburton. He did it with Keegan Murray, who I think was the best player at the given moment, and they're trying to win games. Jairus Walker is the best player here, and this also does make sense because Harrison Barnes is headed toward free agency this next season, assuming that they don't get an extension done with him or don't have long-term plans of keeping him around. Jairus Walker kind of gives you some of what you're losing in Harrison Barnes. He's a very good face up four at this point. He's actually pretty crafty with the ball in his hands, which you wouldn't expect from a player of his build and archetype. You look at his physical profile and you're like, oh, this guy's probably not going to do a ton of ball handling. He'll surprise you with it. He can play make off the move a little bit. And he's also, again, like I said, good in that mid-range area. He's going to be able to hit post fades on you, moving jump shots, something I was not expecting to see. Just again, looking at his physical archetype, I just thought Jairus Walker is not going to be a mid-range scorer. Well, he is. He's a pretty darn good one at that. He has good positional awareness too, offensively. Knows where to be when he doesn't have the ball, which I think was a big positive for Keegan Murray and a big reason why I think Keegan Murray is going to be an all-rookie first-team player this year, because he's just going to be good. He knows what to do. He's a very smart NBA player who's got really good off-ball IQ on both ends of the floor. Jairus Walker checks a lot of those same boxes. I think he's going to be a really nice pickup for Sacramento. Pick 11 now. We have the Charlotte Hornets here, who I think are really going to miss Miles Bridges this year. Obviously, what he did in real life, terrible. Do not want to condone that. I'm not saying they miss him as a person. I just think basketball court-wise, X's and O's, his talent, they're going to miss him as a player. So why not go get the best replacement for him in this draft? Cam Whitmore, who was great. And I mean really put the emphasis on great for the USA U20 basketball team this past summer. Cam Whitmore was the MVP of the team, seemingly was putting up 24 or 25 points every single game en route to a gold medal. And boy, can this guy jump out of the gym. He's like the perfect wing to put next to LaMelo Ball. Cam Whitmore, I think he's going to get really coached up well this year as well at Villanova, a historically great program with historically great coaching. I would trust that they're going to continue to get the job done, even amidst some coaching stuff. I think Cam Whitmore here just makes so much sense for Charlotte. This already feels like one of my favorite mock picks in the entire draft cycle. Last year, it was Mark Williams to Charlotte. Well, look at that. That happened. This year, it feels like Cam Whitmore to Charlotte's one of my favorites. The assumption is they would look for an athletic wing. Someone that, hey, we know that this works pretty well with LaMelo Ball. We saw Miles Bridges do it. Cam Whitmore can do a lot of the same things. And in fact, there might be a little bit more on-ball handling potential with Cam Whitmore that maybe Miles Bridges just didn't have to his game. I think Cam Whitmore, probably not going to be as good of a shooter, especially early in his career, that compared to what Miles Bridges has become over the years. But when it's all said and done, Cam Whitmore, still a very good player, someone I'm very high on. Likely I have him in my top 10 when it comes to my big board by the end of the year. I really like this kid in terms of his talent, his athletic profile. He can jump out of the gym and he knows how to win. We saw that for the USA U20 championship team that went on to win gold. Again, Cam Whitmore, I really like him. This is one of my favorite mocks in this mock draft here, besides Victor Wembanyama 1. This one feels really good to me. Pick 12, Portland Trailblazers here now. It just doesn't feel right saying Portland's not even a playoff team. I love what Portland's done with their roster. I think that Gary Payton II was a great addition. Jeremy Grant really fits what they needed as well. They got so much better defensively. Hopefully Nasir Little and Josh Hart can both stay healthy. And you have a really good collection of wings next to your good, talented offensive guards. Yusuf Nurkic, I think, is a good NBA center. Wouldn't say great, but I would say good. Portland at this point, though, it's kind of weird to see what they would go for. So I'm just going to follow the Mike Schmitz train of thought. What would Mike Schmitz, who's an NBA draft evaluator, someone who that's really where he started to make his money and made his name for himself. Well, he's going to like length. And I'm telling you right now, this is a player I really like. Baba Miller played in Spain last year. 6'11" forward. Probably could play the 3 for you. He's skilled enough offensively, but likely transitions in as a 4. I think he fits better as a 4, but he could maybe play the 3. He could probably slide over to that position. And at 6'11", what are you going to get from a Florida State Seminole? Well, let's think back to guys from the past. You know, Patrick Williams, Devin Vassell, Jonathan Isaac, just to name a few. You're going to get really smart defenders because you cannot play in that system without being a smart defender. Leonard Hamilton is someone who drills home the defensive side of the ball, and it shows in the prospects that FSU puts into the league, right? All of them are good, stout defenders. Baba Miller, he will learn so much. I think he made such a great decision for himself going to Florida State. I think it's a perfect situation for a player of his archetype, his size, frame, length. He's going to fit perfectly at Florida State. And because of that, I think he's going to solidify himself as a likely lottery pick. Because what is there not to love about a 6'11 guy who can protect the rim as a weak side guy, who can shoot the three ball? This feels like Mikal Bridges, but a little bit bigger, not as adept as a perimeter defender at this point. Again, I think he's going to get a lot better this year in that area, but he's probably not going to be a sit down and stop you type of guy, but he's going to be a real force and playmaker on that end of the floor that I really like. Baba Miller feels like a really great fit to Portland here as well. Again, just adding more length and size around your small backcourt always seems like the best case scenario when you have Damian Lillard and Anfernee Simons. Pick 13, we have the New Orleans Pelicans here, which it almost feels unfair that this team might have a lottery pick this year as well, thanks to the Lakers and their trade for Anthony Davis. And now at this spot, the Pelicans are going to go with center slash forward Kyle Filipowski from Duke. And I know this is going to be another one that people say, whoa, really? You have Filipowski going in the lottery? What's your rationale and reasoning behind that? Well, let's look at it from New Orleans' perspective. Jonas Valanciunas, starting center. Backup center, Jackson Hayes, or, you know, they gave the extension there to Larry Nance. Are any of those players super great fits with their guy Zion Williamson? I don't really know. I'm not really sold on that completely. I think that they're all okay fits. I think Valanciunas may be the best fit because he started to shoot a few more threes and stretching the floor. Again, you have to look over to Milwaukee and see how good Brook Lopez has worked with Giannis Antetokounmpo if you're building up New Orleans right now. And I think Kyle Filipowski is the guy for this. He's got a really smooth stroke on the perimeter. He actually can handle the ball a little bit. I think this year for Duke, we're going to see him a lot at the four. But the nice thing for New Orleans, they have so much length around him that they could probably get away with playing him at the five, even though he is rather slight for the position. Just because think about who else you got running around on this team. Zion Williamson, who's one of the most athletic players the league's ever seen. You've got Trey Murphy, whose arms are like 12 feet long. Obviously, I'm being exaggerative, but he's an awesome 3-and-D player. You've got Herb Jones, whose arms are literally 40 feet long. Not exaggerating there. Just seems like he covers the entire court. And he's very instinctual and smart as well. I loved Herb Jones when he came out of Alabama. I have a video of that up on the channel, actually, my 2021 draft board, talking about how much I liked Herb Jones basically for like 5 minutes in that video. And I might even do it for 5 minutes in this one, who knows. But Kyle Filipowski, you know, they have Brandon Ingram there as well. They've got a ton of length. So they can fit around Filipowski in a way that I think would be advantageous for them defensively while still trying to get the most out of their offense by putting Filipowski at the center spot and kind of opening up the lane, pulling out some of that rim protection to open stuff up for Zion Williamson, Brandon Ingram to operate in the mid-range, CJ McCollum to operate in the mid-range. Overall, just feels like a really smart fit for this team, which is really what I think that they have to go for at this point. Draft based off of fit, you have your core, you have your talent. Now you have to find players who fit around that. Pick 14. We have the Orlando Magic here again. And everyone, we better be praying that the Chicago Bulls do not end up being really bad this year, because this pick comes from the Nikola Vucevic trade. And let's just say, hypothetically, the Bulls have a serious injury to one of their best players and they kind of bottom out this year. You know, Lonzo Ball's already dealing with some injury stuff. What if they just, you know, never get off the grounds in a tough East? If they have some injuries and things go awry, maybe the Orlando Magic have really good odds at the top two picks in the draft. Imagine a team with Paolo Banchero and they add in, you know, maybe a Victor Wembanyama and Scoot Henderson in the draft. Oh my goodness, Orlando would be scary. They're probably the only team with a legitimate shot at that this year. Again, I wouldn't bet on that happening, but let's just pray the Bulls stay healthy. But at 14 here, I have them going with GG Jackson. He was originally going to go to UNC, decommitted, went to South Carolina now instead. And I think he's someone who, as a four-man, again, this is a little bit of an awkward fit for Orlando. But I just think at this spot, with the fact that they already went out and got Amen Thompson, you're just trying to find somebody who can give you real good minutes and provides a lot of athleticism. And G.G. Jackson does those things. He runs the floor well. He's going to get around the rim and finish plays off. He's got a very good vertical jump off of 2 feet. And I think he's going to be someone who has really soft hands as well as a pass receiver, which is important for some of those young guards. You know, fit the ball in tight windows. G.G. Jackson's probably going to catch that ball. And he's also a developing rim protector, not necessarily in the form of an anchor. We're not going to see him play center, but we could see him impact shots as a weak side rotation guy. I think that's really where you're going to find some value. Orlando loves length. They're getting it in this draft with Amen Thompson and G.G. Jackson. And by the way, they really fleeced the Bulls on that trade. Pick 15, the Brooklyn Nets here now at this spot. This is one of the most volatile teams. They could be picking 30. They could be picking 15. They could pick 12. I don't know. They could be a lot. Who knows what's going to happen with Brooklyn? I sure as heck don't. They probably won't pick 12. They'll probably be a playoff team. But at 15, I have them going with Ausar Thompson, the brother of Amen Thompson. And he's one of the players I find really hard to find a good fit for because he does a lot of the same stuff Amen Thompson does, which was picked number 4 in this mock, so 11 spots lower. To me, I just think he does a lot of those things worse. And I think because of that, he's just a much less intriguing prospect. I just don't look at him as someone you could really build your team around as much. I think he's a little bit more limited. I think Amen Thompson, clearly the more dominant player. I think Ausar plays more of a wing role than a lead guard role, which is another reason why you lose a little bit of value here. But for Brooklyn, it makes perfect sense to take the gamble on him. You get good size, good athleticism. You have nice length as well with him, and he's going to be able to fill out another spot on your wings. The Nets, one of the issues with them, they've just been too small. They haven't had enough big, lengthy players to deal with the teams like Boston, Milwaukee. And now with Ausar Thompson, it gives you another body to throw at those guys. And again, the talent, the upside is there. If you can get him to, you know, really develop over the first 2 years of his career, maybe he does end up becoming a really great steal at pick 15. I could see him going as high as pick 10. Like I said, he was one of the hardest guys to mock in this one, just because I don't really exactly know where to put him yet at this point. So I look at him and I'm like watching him like, oh, I'm less impressed because I just watched his twin brother play, who was just better than him all game. But it's not like there's a huge drop off between the two. So maybe I'm being a little too harsh on Ausar. Let me know in the comment section what you think. I would love to hear your thoughts, especially early on in the process. Pick 16. Here's the Los Angeles Lakers with that swap that they have from the New Orleans Pelicans because of Anthony Davis this year. Obviously, the Lakers will be hoping that they're better than New Orleans. I don't think that's likely, though, this year. But here at 16, I have the Lakers go with Khalil Ware from Oregon. And you might be saying, whoa, a center pick, that's a little interesting. Yeah, I just don't think that Thomas Bryant or Damian Jones is good enough to get the job done. It seems like the Lakers and Darvin Ham are really buying into Anthony Davis playing the four again. Again, I don't think that's the best course of action. So you draft a five-star center here who I think is going to have a pretty good year at Oregon. It seems like the Oregon prospects never quite live up to hype. But Khloe Ware is someone who I think can give you a real good presence on the glass. He's physically strong. He can play through contact down low. And I think for the Lakers, you're just looking for a serious upgrade at center. And I think Khalil Ware, if they don't make a trade here for Miles Turner and Buddy Hield, Khalil Ware is probably going to be their best long-term option in this next draft cycle. Pick 17, the Atlanta Hawks here now at this spot. And for Atlanta, I really like the fact that they still have this draft pick, even after trading for DeJounte Murray, who I think is a really good, great, even really great addition to that roster. So at 17, I have them going with forward Chris Livingston, who last year they took AJ Griffin. So maybe this pick feels a little redundant and repetitive. Livingston's quite a bit more athletic than AJ Griffin, although, you know, Griffin's battling back from an injury. Griffin has a ton of athleticism in his own right when he's been healthy. Livingston, less of a skill player, I would say, than AJ Griffin, but he puts more force into the ground. He jumps higher. Now, one thing to note is he exclusively jumps off of 2 feet. He is not a 1 foot jumper like Zach LaVine is. He's not going to generate that much power off of one leg, but he is going to bounce off of two rather well, and he's going to be able to flush it over the top. Again, a very athletic player, and his jump shot is something that is coming along. He made a ton of shots this past year. And his shot-making prowess is something that I think at Kentucky, if he shoots the ball well, we could see him soar even higher, maybe even into the top 10. I think for a player this year, Chris Livingston's shooting splits are going to be more important than most other players, just because it's going to really build into validity on whether he's a three-level scorer, two-level scorer, or only a one-level scorer at the rim. I think we're going to have to really watch his shooting splits throughout the year. But he's going to be a player I have my eyes on very closely, especially playing at Kentucky. You know, they're going to be on TV all the time, so I'll be watching them frequently and very often. Pick 18 now. Charlotte's back on the clock again. This pick comes from the Denver Nuggets. And at this point, with them already going out and getting Cam Whitmore, let's go get another guard for them. And I think this is a perfect guard to add in. Cason Wallace, who's another Kentucky Wildcat here. And the reason we're going with Cason Wallace, the defensive upside. I think he's going to be able to provide an element that LaMelo Ball just simply does not to this team. You're drafting him here to be your long-term backup guard, which feels maybe a little weird. You know, pick 18, do you really want to draft someone who's going to be probably a career backup for you? Cason Wallace is not just an average career backup, though. He's a good player who I think does fill a real need for this team. Last year, again, I looked at Mark Williams all year as the guy that they needed to draft to fill the need of rim protection. They did it. This year, now I'm thinking Cam Whitmore, Cason Wallace. We'll see if they do it on draft night, but those two players I think would be really good grabs. Cason Wallace is a player who I had trouble finding a real fit for. The point guard spot in the NBA right now is so strong. Like, do I really see Atlanta doing it after trading for DeJounte Murray? No, not really. They still have Bogdan Bogdanovic as well. I just don't necessarily see that. He fell a little bit here. Charlotte 18, though. Cason Wallace, a really good pickup for that team. Pick 19, the Indiana Pacers here on the clock for a second time. Obviously, earlier on, I had them go with Derek Lively from Duke. And at 19, we're going with forward Arthur Kaluma from Creighton, which I know is going to surprise some people here. I think Kaluma heading into his sophomore season is going to have a huge, and I mean huge, breakout campaign for Creighton. He's going to play so well this next year. And he started to show that in the NCAA tournament this past year. He had some real dominant games, including a 20-plus point scoring output, which was his highest of the year last year. And I think he's going to build off of that. And he's one of those players, again, we're talking prototypical, length, size, defensive intangibles. And he's also someone who is developing offensively. Let's look at it from Indiana's roster perspective right now. They have Halliburton. They have Mathurin. They also drafted another guard in round two. You look at their team, well, we added Derek Lively already. What they need is more forwards. Kaluma gives you length, defense. He's a player that I know Rick Carlisle would love. Completely fits Carlisle's system, both offensively and defensively. Kaluma is going to play within his role, but he's capable of expanding outside of that occasionally. And I think Indiana is going to do a great job drafting Arthur Kaluma on draft night if he's still there for them. Again, right now, a lot of people are looking at Kaluma probably as a second-round guy. I'm higher on him than most. If you watch the channel, you know I don't operate off of consensus. I don't really care what other people are saying. I care what my eyes tell me. I think Arthur Kaluma is a first-round player, at least at this point of the year, before we see all the freshmen really take the court and maybe, you know, two or three guys jump that I wasn't expecting. But at this point, Kaluma, for me, I really like. Pick 20, Phoenix Suns here. And talking about players I really like, they're getting a good one here, assuming that they have this pick on draft night. Guard Anthony Black from Arkansas. I alluded to them earlier. The Razorbacks are going to have multiple players drafted this year in the first round. Nick Smith Jr. is one of them. Anthony Black, another. He's a 6'7" guard. Played point guard in high school. I don't expect he will in the collegiate level, especially next to Nick Smith Jr. I think he's more of a two guard who can do some ball handling for you. But really what was special about Anthony Black, really good defensive playmaker. His arms go on for days, as Jay Billis would say famously. And I think the one thing with him is he's not afraid of getting down, getting dirty. He's going to fight in the passing lanes, but he's also someone who can clamp up on ball when you need to. He's a pesky defender at 6'7", and he's a pretty good athlete for the size as well. He's not going to jump out of the gym, but he's definitely capable of finishing above the rim consistently. And he's a much better passer than I think a lot of other people will give him credit for. I think the big question for him is, what does his ball handling look like? Is he good enough to be a lead ball handler? Probably not, but I think he's a really good number two floor general for a team. He's capable of making all the passes. He can read the opposite floor, throws a ton of one-handed passes, which sometimes can be a little iffy and scary in terms of the turnover numbers, but I'm sure he'll learn from that this year a little bit. And I think the big thing is it gives you more arm angles to throw passes. he's comfortable doing that. He's going to be able to deliver whether his arm's extended, not above his head. He's just a smart player who reads the floor and sees a lot of things. If his handle was tighter, I would say he could be a lead point guard. At this point, I'm a little more skeptical on that, but I think Phoenix at 20 gets a really good, solid guard to complement this team, come off the bench early in his career, and is a real upgrade over a guy like, say, Cam Payne. Just obviously, I think he's going to be better than Cam Payne. Pick 21, the Toronto Raptors here now at this spot, and this is a pick I like a lot. Jalen Hood-Schifino, he's going to Indiana, played at Montverd with some of the players we've talked about earlier, Dariq Whitehead being one of them, and he had a lot of really good chemistry, especially with the guys that could play around the rim. He was very smooth as a passer and someone who, as a guard for them, you know, kind of played combo guard, could score the basketball, but also created for others a bit. I'd like to see him maybe transition into the full-time point guard there, but it's going to be interesting because he's playing with Malik Renew as well, moving forward into Indiana. So they've got an interesting backcourt there, Indiana does. I think they're going to have a really nice season. I'm very excited to watch the Hoosiers play this year, and Jalen Hood-Schifino is a good reason why. Toronto, you get another guard who has pretty adequate size to him, 6'4", 6'5"-ish, and I think can really play either the one or two for you at certain points. I wouldn't trust him being your starting point guard, but in bursts, you could probably play him that way. Kind of similar to what we talked about with Anthony Black, maybe to a lesser extent. I would trust Anthony Black as my one way more than Jalen Hood-Schifino, but to a lesser extent, kind of fills that similar role, which I think for Toronto would be valuable. To play him next to Gary Trent Jr. at times, let him have the ball. Pascal Siakam also takes some of the pressure off, so does Scotty Barnes. So he'd be a pretty good fit here into Toronto, and we know that they like their positional size a lot, although seemingly point guard, they really like to have smaller guys there, Kyle Lowry, Fred VanVleet, Malachi Flynn, of course, but, you know, Jalen Hood-Schifino, he could get in, he can get down, and I think Toronto would really like having him. Pick 22, the Memphis Grizzlies here now, a team that just continues to make good decisions. Taylor Jenkins, one of the best coaches in the league. Obviously, they're young. Executive won Executive of the Year last year as well. Well-deserved. And I have them going with another good pick here. Forward Jordan Walsh, who I think is due for a really nice year playing next to Anthony Black and Nick Smith Jr. He's next to two good playmakers. I think it's going to really open up the floor for him. Anytime he cuts, which is often, he's going to get the ball on time, on target, and it's going to make his life a lot easier. We're looking at a former top 15-ish recruit. Going 22nd overall here, I don't think is out of question, especially assuming he has a pretty good freshman season. Another example here of length, size, athleticism. I think this year Memphis will miss Kyle Anderson a little bit more than they're expecting. I did like the pickup of David Roddy. I also think Jake LaRavia was a solid addition there as well. Not as high on Kenneth Lofton, but maybe he'll have some impact moments this year. I really like the Kennedy Chandler selection. There's not a lot of needs here in Memphis. I think you just go with another wing. They're going to try and put as much length, athleticism, shooting around Ja Morant and Jaren Jackson as possible. I think Jordan Walsh can do most of those things. At this point, we'll see how his three-point shooting really adjusts to the college game. Maybe that becomes the real question mark for him. But athletically, he's gifted, knows how to play without the ball, would be a really nice fit next to Ja Morant. Pick 23, the New York Knicks here now. This pick comes from the Dallas Mavericks in the Kristaps Porzingis trade. And here for the Knicks, with what we went with earlier, we're looking for another impact player, and I think that they could find one here in guard/forward Ryan Rupert. He will be playing for the New Zealand Breakers this year in the NBL, and he's a player that I think more people have to have on their radar. Ryan Rupert is someone who is going to be a very good competitive defender, and as long as Tom Thibodeau is walking the streets of New York, you have to figure he's going to want good defensive players in there. And Ryan Rupert's also shown some signs of shot making that makes you believe he can be a quality 3-and-D player. I think this year for the NBL, it's going to be huge for him. Obviously, you see him played in France the year before. If he shows out for the New Zealand Breakers this year, which I think is possible, you know, usually the NBL lets some of these young players play, and they usually play well for them when they do. I think Ryan Rupert could really solidify himself as a first-round guy. He's one of those fringe guys. Could see him going anywhere from pick 20 to pick 40 at this point. This is the part of the mock draft where things are a little bit more wide open, especially before college basketball season starts. There's so many different questions that aren't answered up to this point, which is really why this mock draft's so fun. This is a preseason mock. We don't know how everything's going to play out at this point, and we have to adjust when it does play out certain ways we weren't expecting. But for me right now, Ryan Rupert, I could look at him being a first-round player, and I think that's very well-deserved at this point. We're going to have some other interesting ones coming up too, so bear with me here a little bit. Pick 24, Indiana Pacers. This pick comes from the Malcolm Brogdon trade for the Boston Celtics. And I have them going with Tre'Quavion Smith, who this probably feels low to some of the other viewers on the channel. Tre'Quavion Smith maybe could have been a first rounder last year, but the fact that he pulled his name makes me think he did not get a guarantee, which means that teams want to see improvement from him in certain areas. Probably, if I had to guess, playmaking. I think his playmaking timing needs to improve. We know he can score the basketball, and this is where I think this would be a really nice get for Indiana if they find him at 24. Here's your bench spark plug, like, hey, we're going to give him the ball and let him go score 12 to 18 points a night. And I think he's really capable of that. The question is, does that playmaking come around enough? And what does he look like defensively? I think six man is really going to be the role Tre'Quavion Smith falls in down the road. I remember a game against Purdue last year where Tre'Quavion Smith was arguably the best player on the floor with Jaden Ivey on the other side. He had moments where he was just making shot after shot after shot, and you could not believe what you were watching. This kid can fill it up in bunches. I really do like his talent, but the fact that he did not come out last year makes me think that teams were a little gun shy on him. I still think he's a first round level talent this year, but maybe not as high as some other people are projecting. Perhaps he has a monster sophomore season though. Then we forget everything I just said and we put him in the lottery and say, hey, Tre'Quavion Smith, you're a beast. Pick 25 now, Miami Heat here. And the one thing I still want to see this team address, backup center. I know I really like Omer Yurt 7, but I think their front court took a hit losing PJ Tucker. And I think this year is the year that they're going to have to really find someone who can fill that backup five spot and do it consistently. And Daron Holmes is the player who I have going here from the Dayton Flyers. I told you guys Obi wasn't going to be the only Dayton Flyer we talked about in this video. Daron Holmes is set, and I mean really set and due for a huge sophomore season. Not very often you see Dayton Flyers go in the first round of the draft. Very rarely. In fact, this is only the second ever Dayton Flyer I've mocked in the first round of a draft. The last one was Obi Toppin. I was doing it right away at the beginning of that season. I told everyone before Obi's final season at Dayton that he was going to be a player to watch for. Dayton ascended to the number two seed in the entire country. Now, Dayton won't have that same jump this year. They're not that good this year. But Daron Holmes is that good this year. He's a player who's a first-round worthy player. And I think he's going to have a really nice season in the A-10. A little bit lesser competition, so he gets to show out a little bit. But we've seen stories like this before where a guy dominates lesser competition, ends up becoming a first-round pick. I think Daron Holmes fits all the criteria. If you haven't watched this kid play, please do. Good athlete. He's really expanding on his game, especially offensively at this point. And I really do believe he's going to have a nice sophomore season. Pick 26, we have the LA Clippers here now. And this is one of my favorite mock selections of the draft. We're going to tell very quickly into the season if this is at all accurate or not. I'm taking a little bit of a gamble risk here. Dawson Garcia, he was a player who went to school in Minnesota for high school. He played at Prior Lake High School, Prior Lake Lakers, and he went to UNC and sat on the end of the bench for most of the year. He was shooting a lot of spot-up jump shots for them and just didn't really have a real role on that team. So what does he do? He transfers back to his home state, Minnesota, where he's going to be the feature player for the Golden Gophers. And I think for a program that is looking for a guy to go to this year, him and Jamison Battle are going to be the two guys really scoring a ton. And I think Dawson Garcia is going to be the one that's impressive. Former four-star recruit. A lot of eyes are going to be on him. Very athletic as well from the big man position. You could play him at the five or the four. Probably at the NBA level, he's more of a four than a five consistently. But we also know one thing here. The Clippers tend to look at the Minnesota Golden Gophers program rather consistently. We saw them take Amir Coffey from Minnesota. He was an undrafted player. They brought him in. We saw them draft Daniel Aturu in round two a couple years ago. Now, that one didn't pan out very well. I could have told you that in advance. But here, Dawson Garcia from the Golden Gophers. I could see the Clippers taking him. Again, really quickly into the college season, we'll see if this pick is actually something that's plausible or not. I wouldn't be shocked if Dawson Garcia does get drafted this year. Might not be a first-round level guy, though. Trust me, again, this is the one I'm taking a risk on. Very possible we don't see him in round one. It's possible we don't even see him in the draft at all. I'm kind of buying on the stock a little bit here when it's really low, but quickly in the season I might sell depending on what it's looking like out in Minnesota. Pick 27, Utah Jazz on the clock again. They do have three first-round picks. Here's the second one, of course. They went with Scoot Henderson at pick number two, and we're going to build off of that with the high upside, arguably a potential steal in this draft, arguably a bust in this draft, whatever you want to think. forward Amani Bates. He is going to be someone who still gets talked about in the first round, even after an arrest. He's had some off the court stuff, didn't really fit in at Memphis. The one thing I'm going to say about that, though, remember, he reclassified. He was really young. He should not have went to college as early as he did, and I think it really hurt his draft stock because of that. But what I do know, Amani Bates is a big wing who can handle the ball, and he can shoot. Now, he didn't shoot well at Memphis last year, but I think Eastern Michigan, back home, he's hopefully going to have a little bit more statistical success this year. And we still saw a guy like Patrick Baldwin a year ago get drafted in the first round. Amani Bates is going to have a better year this year than Patrick Baldwin did. Whatever excuses you use for Patrick Baldwin, you better keep him ready for Amani Bates, because it's going to be a similar storyline here. You know, hyped up high school prospect, doesn't perform at the collegiate level as well as expected. The only difference here, Amani Bates isn't getting coached by his dad and still struggling. So I think Amani Bates, especially with his connections, Chris Brickley really likes him. He has a lot of influence in the league. He's a trainer. If you guys don't know who Chris Brickley is, you're probably living under a rock. Amani Bates, I think, is going to be very successful at Eastern Michigan, even if it doesn't mean like great overall play. He's going to be much more successful than he was last year at Memphis. And I think that's all you can really ask for if you're him. And again, when you get him into a gym, one-on-one workouts, one-on-all workouts, he's going to be impressive. He's going to have length, size, shot-making potential, can handle the ball as a wing. Those are things you usually fall in love with. Plus, Danny Ainge has all these picks to take risks on. Why not use one of them on Amani Bates? Then pick 28, we're staying here with the Utah Jazz. This pick is from the 76ers through the Brooklyn Nets, which is from the Royce O'Neal trade. And with this pick, we're going to have them go with a safer selection. Chris Murray, forward out of Iowa. And he's one of those players to watch this year. Someone who could have a huge breakout campaign. We saw it last year with Keegan Murray. He had a massive jump himself. Now will Chris Murray have the same jump? I'm less certain on that, but I think we're going to see a much better Chris Murray this next season than we saw last year. Keegan really stole the show there in Iowa. There's no denying that. But I think Chris Murray could have a nice impact this year, especially in the absence of his brother. And for Iowa, they're going to need him to do that. In a tough Big Ten, they're going to need Chris Murray to step up. A lot of the Big Ten schools did lose some of their best players, though. So maybe it's a more open Big Ten than we typically see. And Chris Murray could maybe take advantage of that as well. Utah, again, here, you're swinging for a kind of maybe upside. Chris Murray, is he a late bloomer? What can he become? Utah, I really like this draft. Scoot Henderson, Amani Bates for upside. Chris Murray, a little safe, but maybe he has a breakout year this year. And then maybe there's some upside there as well. So I really like this for Utah. I think this would be a really strong first-round draft for them. Pick 29, Houston Rockets on the clock again. This pick comes from the Milwaukee Bucks. And at this spot, I have them going with guard Dior Johnson. Very interesting here. You're going to see I have him above Amari Bailey, which is interesting as well, because Dior Johnson decommitted from UCLA once Amari Bailey committed there, which showed that he wasn't confident he was going to be the starting point guard there. So what does he do? He transfers to Pittsburgh late, and everything I've seen from him in camp there, working with the Pittsburgh coaching staff, working in scrimmages, he has looked awesome. One thing I really like about Dior Johnson, at only about 6'3", he's a grinder. He's a hustler. He's going to hunt down rebounds. He's a real effort guy, and he can also read the floor. He's a very good playmaker. And I think, again, with Houston, we went with Derek Whitehead early. We're still looking at that point guard spot. Do we have a point guard? Is Ty Washington going to be that guy? Does Kevin Porter Jr. take a step forward this year? Well, here's a playmaker for us sitting here at this spot for the Houston Rockets, Dior Johnson. I think a good option, someone who's gotten a lot of love and hype from his mixtapes, obviously. I think that there is a legit player in here that can make an impact at the NBA level. And it speaks to the strength of this class. I'm getting a good guard here, 29th overall. Just like last year, Ty Washington went in the late 20s. I feel good about Dior Johnson here as well. For Houston, you have to take stabs at that point guard spot, see if you can figure it out. Otherwise, it becomes a more pressing need down the road. And then pick 30, final pick of the first round. And we got the reigning Golden State Warriors here. And I say reigning because they're the reigning champions. And they might, again, by the time the draft happens this next year, they are so, so good. So if you're a Warriors fan, shout out to you, as long as you're a real one and not one of those bandwagons, right? But nonetheless, I have the Warriors going with forward slash guard Baylor Shireman from Creighton. Last year played at South Dakota State. He was a jackrabbit and got a lot of notoriety leading up into the NCAA tournament and in the first round of the NCAA tournament. He's someone who can really shoot the basketball, but he's also kind of got a little bit of Joe Ingles in him. And I say that affectionately. Joe Ingles was one of the more underrated players in the league from about 2015 to 2019. Ingles is somebody who he could handle the basketball, be another pick and roll ball handler for you, which you can never have enough of in today's NBA. But he was also really good at spacing the floor, one of the areas he really improved after going undrafted, what feels like over a decade and a half ago almost at this point, clearly not that long ago. But Baylor Shireman kind of has a lot of those same characteristics. Handled the ball a ton at South Dakota State, very talented shooter. And this is a very nice, safe selection for Golden State and someone who I would almost count on being a rotation player at some point for them. The one issue is they've got so much young talent already and so many good established players. They don't need a player like Baylor Shireman. They really don't. But the rich get richer here. Why not take him? A lot of people probably won't look at him as a first-round guy. Probably could see him going anywhere from 31 to 45. But, I mean, if a team's going to take him in round one, why not Golden State? He's safe. He's going to be productive when he plays, and he's smart. Now, does he have the athleticism to be a 30-minute-a-game guy in the NBA? No, I don't think so. But I think he can survive 10 to 15, 10 to 20 minutes a game, especially in Golden State where, you know, that team has so much in, you know, built into what their identity is, both offensively and defensively. I think Shireman would be a really nice fit on both ends. Thank you guys so much for watching. Make sure you leave a like and also subscribe for more future NBA draft content like this. Let me know in the comment section if you have any questions about any of these prospects. I can elaborate a little bit more on a lot of these guys for you if you'd like to hear more. Go check out some of my other videos. Make sure you go check out that Scoot Henderson, Victor Wembanyama breakdown. I'd love for you guys to completely catch that one, see what that game was all about as well. Remember, this is getting sandwiched in between the October 4th and October 6th games. Thanks again so much for watching, guys, and we'll catch you in the very next Utility Sports video.